And February, my youngest son, 23-year-old, he passed away in a most tragic circumstance. The evening went out, we had a big family gathering. Next morning he came, as I'm going about early morning, I'm at my prayers. And then suddenly, early morning, he just walked into my room after he had a bath. He came into my room. He joined me for my prayers. I took him out into the garden. He followed me, I plucked flowers, you know. Then he came, asked to sing a song. He sang a song, you know. Then I go to office, I say, I'll see you in the evening, son. At 4 o'clock in the office, I hear news that he has jumped off a building and committed suicide. Therefore, in my own life, I found incredible success, you know, in my work career, what have you. But this does not mean that we don't face personal challenges in life. I tell people, listen, don't think just because you're praying to God or because you're doing service, you're spared, you know, from the tragedies of life, you know. The secret of spirituality is to understand the whole life is a drama, that each of us are playing a role. The secret of happiness is to play your role well.
While devoted to holy man Sri Satya Sai Baba, Jagadishan of Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, has suffered enormous tragedies. First, the loss of his wife, and then the loss of his son. Here, Jagadishan finds spiritual perspective for his life. Welcome to Soul Journeys. This interview was recorded in Grants Pass, Oregon, in July of 2004.
Jaga, thank you very much for making yourself available on very short notice. And if I may be so bold, I would like to ask you right at the top to recount some of your own personal experiences of the last several years, of the last several months, of tremendous personal loss in the shadow of Sai Baba, and how you have found your way through that darkness.
Okay. I think, as I mentioned earlier today, as you know, I came from a background, I was born in a Hindu family, but became an atheist very early in life, an agnostic, and thinking that God is imagination, religion is just, opium for the people. And until then, Baba came to my life, and I was a strong anti-Sai Baba, and a miracle happened, you know, and then I realized, hey, look, there's a force beyond science. And this force is a force that you can reach out to and will respond. It is then I went into Baba's teachings, and then I realized what Baba's message is to the world. He said, there's only one God for all mankind. You call him by different names. Number two, follow your religion. He says a Christian must become a better Christian. Hindu must become better Hindu. Buddhist, better Buddhist. Number three, he says, respect and revere all religions, because all come from the same one God. All ask you to do the same thing. Number four, he says, follow values in life. Follow values in your own life and try to promote these values in society where values are now rapidly declining. And number five, do service for humanity, selflessly. This is the essence of his teaching. Five drops of the ocean, I call it. In my own life, therefore, since I became involved with Swami at the age of 32, now I'm 60, so you can see I've gone a long way. I've tried to implement this, you know. And in Malaysia, for example, which is an Islamic nation, and a lot of restrictions are there, you know, in terms of a lot of things. But in Malaysia, it's a beautiful nation with a lot of interracial harmony, interreligious harmony. Today, if you go to Malaysia and ask which people are involved in human value programs, Sai Baba, automatically. And if you ask who's in the forefront of interfaith, interreligious harmony, Sai Baba. It is because so, as Christ said, no, by your work you'll be known. So today, I mean, in the government circles in Malaysia, in the religious circles in Malaysia, we are recognized and respected, okay, for what we have done. Basically because the Christ message, by your work you'll be known. Not by the talk, you know. Baba, whatever, we can claim Baba to be anything. Avatar, God, holy man, but who cares? Unless they see that the rest of the world must see that because of this particular personality's appearance in the world must benefit. We must benefit, and we must show the world that we have transformed. The greatest message Baba has done in my life is not the miracles, you know, Baba has done, you know, so much, you know, in Malaysia, around the world. You see in Malaysia, holy ash pouring from pictures. You see materialization taking place far out of Baba's physical presence. But the greatest miracle is transformation of man, to transform very selfish individuals, to become caring and for the community, for the people that they're with. So, like this, my greatest challenges in life has been to try to implement, you know, action programs, agenda of action in Malaysia and wherever, whoever wants to listen, okay? So, before I come to my personal, what are my greatest experiences is this, you know, the fact that Malaysia is a Muslim country, we were able to break through many of the restrictions and suspicions of people by simply selfless service. We went down and served and served and served. And finally, very people who were very suspicious initially, why you're doing this, began to say, hey, these guys are okay. I mean, they are doing very good work and helping everybody, and they're not having any personal agenda. That was the whole question of selfless service again. You see, today when I look around the world and I see many service going on by many SAI organizations, and I find, ask myself, what's happening? What are we doing now? You know, and we do old folks home or soup kitchen or sandwiches. You know, I said, look, the 1,000 other NGOs are doing the same thing, and how come we are doing the same thing? You mean the others are doing the same thing without an avatar, a godman coming and telling them to do? We need a godman to come and tell us to do the same thing others are doing. We must be doing something else. What is the why has he come? If we believe he's an avatar, a divine incarnation, why has he come? Then I realized the two things now in the world today that governments are unable to handle, that religious leaders are unable to handle, what is it that needs a divine intervention? That is the decline of values, pervasive decline of values. And you see the everyday newspapers scream at us, you know, on what's happening, you know, promiscuity, youth misbehavior, drugs and sexuality, this and the other. And people are unable to handle this. And long before all this became major problem in the world, Baba has already talked about the human value program. He says we must, so in Malaysia we launch massive pervasive value program into society in a very fun way, you know. See, youth, we cannot tell the youth, you know, you must behave yourself or you go to hell. They'll say, heaven is, after hell is full of adults, you know, so why worry, you know. But we must therefore make values fun for the youth, okay, and exciting for the youth. And that's what we did in Malaysia. We made values, we had we had a human value drama festivals, human value song festivals. We made values a fun thing for the youth. The other great challenge is, people weren't aware of this until September 11th, okay, 9/11, where we found for the first time in human civilization, religions are staring at each other across oceans, you know, in hostility and fear. I mean, and that's an, I can imagine if you're God, okay, and you're sitting there in heaven or wherever, and you've sent great godmen or incarnations and holy men, and you have come yourself, you know, send your son or whatever it is, to create so many religions, for what? To create peace and harmony. And suddenly you find that the very religions that you have sent, you've created through your messiahs or whatever is the cause of the greatest problem and fear in the world today. So if you are God, what do you do? Hey, I better come down and sort this out myself, okay? So Swami has manifested here. Don't forget, after September 11th, many, many groups got together, interfaith dialogues, you know, just to, as a reaction to a crisis. But here we are, such an organization is already an interfaith organization set up there by Swami to create interfaith unity. And Swami says, unity is divinity. So we in Malaysia launched massive interfaith programs. So today we have got something called the Friendship Group for Interreligious Service. We've got the Catholic Church with us, we've got the Muslims with us, we've got the Buddhists, the Hindus, the Sikhs, and the Council of Churches representing the Protestant groups, all together doing service, and we are leading the whole program. And they're prepared and they're happy to accept our leadership because they know we have no agenda. You know? And we know, last year we launched one medical camp, interfaith. It's called a friendship with interreligious medical camp. You know, so the many people do.